that Fiona organized this book and that she chose this topic. And I really recommend it very highly. I recommend that you read it and meditate upon it. It's a very powerful book. It's a book that in a way ties in. It's about fear, but it's a book that ties in many different struggles, you know, and shows, moves along different themes. First, the incredible violence that is the history of capitalism, how violence has been there all along from the beginning of capitalism to this day, how it has been so structurally part of every economic change, economic imposition. You know, violence, you know, the famous point of Marx that violence has been an economic force. It's, you can see it because the book moves from an interview with Marcos Rediker about the pirates and about dispossession and enclosure in the 16th century, slavery, and it ends with in the mountains of Guatemala, you know, with testimonies about the massacres and the tortures that were carried out against the insurrections in the 1980s. So you see the continuity of the violence, but you also trace a whole continuity of struggle, which is very, very powerful. And all along, you see that the violence exists because of the struggle, that the violence has existed because without that violence, that incredible destruction of life and use of terror as a key strategy, capitalism would never have been able to prevail. And in fact, it's quite encouraging, in my view, you know, to think, for example, when you think of the history, the recent history of Latin America, you know, from the 50s to the present, you know, few countries has been tortured and have seen so much destruction as Latin America. And nevertheless, today, it's one of the parts of the world, the regions of the world, where the struggle is most strong, is most alive, right? So it really shows, it's one response, you know, to the fear of this violence, because the violence is the measure of the struggle. The violence is the measure of the resistance. And another important theme, I think, that runs through the book, and maybe I can connect in terms of my, you know, of my comments, or some of my comments, has been, you know, the importance of, you know, social relation, you know, the construction of a social fabric, and solidarity, social solidarity, and collective memory, the ability to preserve and to reconstruct the collective memory, how that has been important in giving people courage, you know, in enabling people not to be destroyed, you know, by the politics of terror. And this, you know, collective memory and social fabric is what I had in mind, you know, when I spoke about the experience of World War II. I come from a part of Italy that had a communist tradition. In fact, it was one of the three regions in Italy, it was Emilia, that were communist until the 70s. My region in particular had a whole history of partisan movements. So when I grew up after the war, you know, the story of the partisan and the incredible, you know, courage in terms of fighting fascism first, the fascist, and then later on also the Nazi after Italy was occupied. And you know, I grew up in an environment where almost every street around where I lived was the name of somebody who had died, you know, either under torture or executed, you know, in the period, some names of partisans. And so, as a young woman, that was a question. The question is, how did they do it? You know, what gave them the courage? What enabled them to defy, you know, a system that was so incredibly brutal? And so the question, in fact, of first of all, organization, many of those who had been, who came forward and fought, and people had been organized already. And second, also, the sense of identification, the sense of connectedness in the community. In other words, people came from communities to which they were deeply, in which they were deeply rooted. And I think that's extremely important, you know, that ability to see your life as part of something broader than yourself, you know, that ability to live your life not as a kind of atomized individual where you feel completely vulnerable, you know, to the social forces surrounding you, but to feel it as part of a community, to feel that you are in a body and in a self, part of a collective self, much the, in a way that goes beyond your individual life. I think that gives you a tremendous amount of courage. It gives you the capacity to, in a way, overcome the fear of the destruction of your own life. And I think that that's extremely important. And it's something that I think you find in many of the stories that circulate throughout the book. No? And that's why I think that for me, particularly in more and more in recent years, the question of constructing collective memory, maintaining, reconstructing it, it's so important, you know, precisely because there are different ways in which you can go beyond your individual life, you know, immediately as you're part of a community, and also less directly in terms of being able to be part of a history, you know, to see yourself as part of a longer struggle, connect with those who have come before you, who have struggled before you. And I was in Mexico recently, and I spoke with a woman who, for the last 2 years, has been going around different communities and basically documenting struggles that people are making, particularly against mines, against expropriation, against the paramilitaries that are coming together with the mining companies, and which is really now very, very pervasive in Mexico. You know, I mean, 100,000 people have been killed in the last 15, 20 years. And usually, you know, it is said that these are narco people, but in reality, many are killed by the army and are killed by paramilitary workers for the government. Mm. What she found when she went around in this community is that in many cases where struggle seemed completely doomed because you had small people, a small community fighting against big mining company, is that in reality, in many cases, in the end, that community was able to prevail. And then an important factor was how much the community had a sense of his own history, had a sense of his own attachment, the attachment to the land, the attachment to a acknowledged identity, acknowledged history, that this often was a very, very important factor in the struggle. You know, that to know, for example, that you know, the land in which you live or for which you're fighting, you know, is the land in which the people that came before you, the struggle before you, that you love, that been buried, you know, to be aware of that history. You know, the environment around you is an environment that speaks to you, that is a living, organic environment. You know, it's not just only forests and lakes and mountains, but has a whole history, and that ties you up to other people. That this was a very important factor in motivating people to resist even a great risk for their lives. And I think that this, to me, remains one of the key factors in making the difference between paralysis, between trying to withdraw and make yourself as invisible and possible to power, or being able to risk and being able to be ready even to give your life, or to risk a very atrocious death, as often is the case, because in the end, it's that connection with other people, it's that connection with that history that gives you the power to say, well, if I die, it's not all over. And if I die, actually, it gives a meaning to a struggle that is bigger than me, is larger than me,